Coming up next on Breaking Bread, we're heading over to a parish community in Brooklyn that recently received a very special papal honor.
And then we're off to a very popular Italian restaurant.
So don't go anywhere, because all that is next on Breaking Bread. Welcome to Breaking Bread. I'm Johanna Botta.
And I'm Monsignor Jamie. And the church that Johanna is speaking about is the new Basilica of Regina Pacis.
Regina Pacis Basilica is not only a beautiful church, but an unusual one on all accounts, even its location, 65th Street between 12th and 13th Avenues. Putting the Basilica in the center of three Brooklyn neighborhoods, Bensonhurst, Dyker Heights, and Borough Park. This architecturally magnificent church was also dedicated to the Blessed Virgin Mary of Peace and is rich in history and miracles. In December of 2012, Regina Pacis made history. As the metropolitan area was recovering from Hurricane Sandy, Pope Benedict VI honored Regina Pacis by designating it a minor basilica, making it the third in Brooklyn.
So, Monsignor, what's the difference between a major basilica and a minor basilica?
Okay, there are only four major basilicas in the world, and all four are in Rome.
Ah, lucky.
And they are like St. Peter's Basilica, St. Mary Major, St. John Lateran, and St. Paul Outside the Walls. All other ones are minor basilicas.
But what makes it a major basilica?
The history of those particular basilicas.
Is there anything different that you have to do now as a basilica that you didn't have to do before?
Well, there, yes. For example, one of the regulations is that on Sundays the people have to sing the Our Father in Latin, and to join them together with the Roman basilicas that are singing in Latin. Papal-type feast days are celebrated solemnly here, and there are also some of those days where the people who visit here can get plenary indulgences, which they can't get in their local parish.
Now, I know people come to this church mainly to pray and also to take in the beautiful stained glass windows and the beautiful paintings, but I know a lot of people come just to see the crown of jewels on our Blessed Mother.
Right. That's a very important part of the history of the parish. When they were building this church in 1949 and 1950, was a war just ending. And people built the church as a vow to Our Lady for peace in the world. In front of the church, it says that in Latin on the facade, this is built as a vow for peace in the world. And that was also a way of them to raise money for the building of this place. They gave their jewelry, they gave diamonds. Anyway, they got all those jewels and melted them down and did what they had to do. And as a result, they made two tiaras out of 18 karat gold filled with precious stones. One goes on the head of Our Lady, and the other goes on the head of the infant Jesus on her lap. And those are extremely precious because they are the vows of the family members whose sons and daughters were soldiers. And they were asking Our Lady to protect them. Basically, the reason that they're not out all the time is because after 10 days that they were put up, they were stolen.
So what happened?
And this became a big, for the Italians, this became a big horror story.
Of course, it was like what they had given.
Exactly.
It was, but it's so not the end of the story.
It's so emotional that was taken. So, of course, the police were called, the FBI was called, everybody of law enforcement was called, and they couldn't find them, okay? So the pastor went to some other powerful enforcement people. He asked for help from any source he could get. And 3 days later, they were returned perfectly intact. And he showed the people, there are pictures that he stood on the altar, showed the people the two crowns. And then he said, Our Lady made a miracle, the miracle of Bensonhurst. And in order to thank her for returning our crowns intact, I want you to give me 1,000 diamonds so that we can make the 12 stars, the diadem that goes around her head. And believe it or not, they did. And when the jewels are put up, which is on Mother's Day every year, you see the two crowns and you see the 12 diamond stars made of 1,000 diamonds. And the windows, I should point out, are all images of Our Lady taken from the Litany of Loreto.
What's very interesting too is this painting in the center on the ceiling, because it's none of the saints or the angels, but we have people from the parish. I see we have the bishop, we have Pope Pius, and we also have the pastor of the parish, Chofi.
Right.
And that's very interesting. And the rest are parishioners from the neighborhood.
Local parishioners and friends of Monsignor Chofi.
Right.
People who helped him in the construction of the church. The local clergy on the other side, like Archbishop Molloy, who was the Bishop of Brooklyn at the time. And there are some popular saints, like Dominic Savio and other saints that the people would know and pray to in that era.
What's the main big building in the ceiling?
That's this church. The whole picture in the middle is Pope Pius XII, who was the Pope, offering the church, Regina Pacis, to Our Lady. And if you follow that whole picture along the thing, you see that's what it is. So it's an image of Regina Pacis. Right. Okay.
Very interested in this church, and I've never seen in any other church, is the rainbow.
Oh, yeah.
That's very interesting.
Yeah, because it's a symbol of Mary, you know, and all around that rainbow are the symbols of Mary, like Gate of Heaven, Rosa Mystica, all that. They're all up there. They thought of every detail. You know, I've been in this parish for many years, and every time I come in here to pray, you just sit there and look around, and I still discover stuff that I didn't see ever before.
There is one painting on top of one of the windows.
St. Francis Xavier Cabrini was canonized the same year this church was built and dedicated. And she's the first American saint, Italian-American. So in honor of the fact that she was canonized that year, they put her picture up there, and every Italian knew who she was.
Such a beautiful church. Yeah. I know I was here about 15 years ago when you put in that beautiful shrine to Our Lady of the
Mary
Unborn.
Mother of the Upper.
And I know that people come from all over and they make a vow that, you know, they bring their petitions and they light candles.
They pray to have a baby.
To have a baby, or babies that are sick, or, you know, difficult pregnancies.
And then after the babies are born, they come back and they give us their picture.
Right.
As a way to say thank you to Mary for the safe delivery. And when and if you go in that chapel, you'll see hundreds of pictures of babies.
That's so sweet.
And I have cases and cases of pictures for over the years. What I like the best is when husbands come in without their wives knowing it, and they write a prayer to Mary to protect their wife.
Wow.
That's a very beautiful thing.
There's no doubt that this church truly is part of the history of this diocese, and it's an icon here in this neighborhood.
Yeah.
And you're doing a great job.
Thank you. It's a great parish. It's not just the church, the people are wonderful here. And every culture that comes walks through the door of the church and goes, wow.
Yeah,
no matter where they came from, they all have that same reaction.
Monsignor Marino, thank you so much for showing us around and telling us a little bit more about the history of this really, truly gorgeous basilica.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
If you happen to be in Bensonhurst, please come by this beautiful Basilica of Regina Pacis to say a prayer or just to take in the beauty.
Also, come visit Brooklyn's oldest Catholic gift shop located in the Conference Center of Regina Pacis Basilica. And up next, we're heading over to 11th Avenue to have some of those world-famous lemon drop cookies. So don't go anywhere.
I can't wait. Welcome back to Breaking Bread, and we're headed over to Mama Rayo's and Pasta Fresca on 11th Avenue.
Where maybe we'll get the secret recipe to those famous lemon drop cookies we told you about.
You never know.
Everyone knows that the food of Mama Rayo's is delicious, but their lemon drop cookies are legendary.
And the owner of Pasta Fresca and Mama Rayo's is Charlie Rayo. Now, you're the one who holds the secret to the lemon drop cookies.
Well, yeah, one of the people that holds the secret.
Which you're going to share with us, right?
Well, yeah, to a point, absolutely.
Partially.
Absolutely. So, speaking of secrets, earlier on, I got to try this delicious mozzarella.
Yes.
Please tell me, how do you make mozzarella? Because it's never tasted that good.
Well, we do it like from old world recipes, like not really a recipe, it's more like of a technique on how it's made. We cut up the curd nice and small, you know, we salt it, we add hot water to it, we bring it up to a boil, we melt it all together, we pull out all the knots out of it, and then slowly, as it comes smooth and nice textured, we break it up and put it into a bath of cold water with some salt in it, so that way it gives us some flavor. But we have to do it quickly, so that way we keep all the ingredients into the curd and we don't overcook it.
I've never had the mozzarella warm like I had it today. I mean, is there like any specific trick? I know you were saying that there is, right?
Well, it tastes best warm. There's nothing like warm mozzarella, freshly made. And when they take it out of the water, it's still warm. But when you take it home, you put it in the refrigerator, it really doesn't taste the same. The best thing to do is let it sit at room temperature or maybe put it in the microwave for a few seconds and then it's just like fresh.
Absolutely.
Let's talk about the lemon drop cookies. I know you're not gonna give us all of your secrets today, but let's start off with how do you make a lemon drop cookies? Because they're so famous in Brooklyn. Everybody talks about them that I wanna try one.
Well, with lemon drop cookies, what happens is that we use always fresh ingredients and we try not to, like we don't add any preservatives or anything like to keep them. We use the fresh lemon oil directly from Virginia Dare. We use, we have sugar, we have flour, we have shortening, fresh eggs, and some baking powder that gets mixed up. There's different amounts of the ingredients and everything. We mix the dough and then we have the guys roll it out for use for later on.
So this is the mixture already of the lemon oil, the sugar, the baking powder, the eggs, the shortening, and the flour, right?
Absolutely.
Okay.
So it's like more of a dough than a batter. It's crossed between a cake and a cookie.
Exactly.
And I think that's what makes them so special.
Exactly.
And of course, the icing on top.
This was a recipe that my mother brought back from her country that her grandmother taught her. My father then one day decided to say, why don't we try to make them for the store? We started making them.
So is the art in rolling them?
Yes, it is actually. The art is in the dough making itself, on the texture of the dough and how it comes out and how to roll them out.
Well, I have a little secret for you. Do you know who one of your biggest fans are?
Exactly.
Bishop DiMaggio. He loves your lemon drop cookies.
Okay, well, I would love to see how to roll them so I can eat one.
Okay.
There's some that are twisted and there's some that are done machine that are
flatter. Right, right.
Is there a difference in how?
No, not really. Well, these, when they're rolled, it's like old. This is old school, basically. So this is like the old-fashioned way.
The ones for production, you do the machine.
Exactly.
Monsignor Jamie and I get in there and see
Absolutely.
If we can roll it. Oh, it's nice and warm.
It's still warm.
Okay, Charlie, so we put them in the oven, now they're out, right. And we are ready to coat them.
Exactly.
So here's the icing. What is in this icing?
Well, icing is really, it's confectionery sugar,
okay.
Some water, and a little bit more lemon oil just to give more flavor to the icing itself.
So there is no actual like lemon juice. It's all done with the lemon oil, same from the cookies.
Right.
Okay, so what do we do here?
Okay, right now we take a cookie, we throw it in, and we brush off the excess,
okay.
If you don't mind. And then you just keep going.
No.
But I want mine with lots of frosting.
Now it's gonna stick to the paper.
Sorry guys, I really wanted to make mine with lots of frosting.
You're not watching your weight.
See?
Sorry about that.
You're not getting that one, that one's mine. Cheers.
Cheers.
Mmm.
Moist.
You're so right.
They melt in your mouth.
About the texture. It is a very good like halfway point between a cake because they're so soft and
Exactly.
And the icing, it's not that sweet.
No.
You taste the lemon.
I love how soft they are.
So when life gives you lemons,
we make lemon drops.
If you want to try these lemon drop cookies at home, here's a recipe for you guys. And if you don't think you have what it takes to bake these delicious lemon drop cookies, you can always come to Pasta Fresca. So here's the address.
Weren't those lemon drop cookies great?
Oh, I ate way too many.
I didn't count.
Don't go anywhere, guys.
Because up next, we have Monsignor Jamie cooking up a storm.
Welcome back to Breaking Bread. And today on our cooking segment, I'll be preparing one of my family's favorite, Grandma's eggplant meatballs. And what it is a cross between traditional meatballs and eggplant parmesan. Some of the ingredients we're using, first we begin with our meat, and I like to use traditionally pork, veal, and beef. And I have about 10 ounces of each. Then we'll mix that with some eggplant that I got a whole eggplant and I skinned it, cubed it, and I boiled it, and then I drained it to get all the water out. And then we put in their traditional meatball makings. We have some grated cheese, Parmesan cheese. We have garlic, a couple of eggs, parsley, basil. And I like to use fresh bread, or I should say stale bread, which is Italian bread that we soak, and usually you let it sit for a day or two to get stale. And then some people will soak it in water, some people soak it in milk. I like to use both. So let's get to work. Here we go. We have our meat right here, and I'll just throw this in, and here we have our beef, meat, and pork. Here is the eggplant that we cooked, we boiled, and we drained out the water so that it's not too wet. Throw this right in here. We throw in two eggs, some Parmesan cheese, some garlic. Okay. I'll chop up some fresh basil here. I like to use fresh. A lot of people use jarred or dried, but I believe everything should be fresh. Throw in some fresh basil, and then we'll get some fresh parsley. I like to use the Italian parsley, the large leaf parsley. The American parsley I like to use for garnishing, but for cooking, I always like to put in the fresh Italian parsley. You want to chop it up, you don't want it to be too big because you don't want that to get stuck between your teeth while you're eating. And of course, as this cooks, it'll melt down also. Okay, throw that in. We'll put a little salt and pepper here. Pepper. Okay. We'll mix this all together. And then I'll throw in the bread. Now, of course, you'll only use the white of the bread. You don't want to use the crust. And mix that all together. go to the bottom. You want to mix all the ingredients in. I'll then take our bread. What we do is we just take the white of the bread, throw it in. Some people use breadcrumbs, but I like to use the fresh bread. I feel that they come moist. When people make meatballs, every meatball tastes different. No matter whose home you go into, they all taste different. You ask them what they put in, all the same ingredients, but they all taste different. Okay, once this is all mixed, I'll start making my small meatball patties. Prepare our casserole dish. As I said, we use a little gravy here. And we put some gravy on the bottom so it doesn't stick. So here I have grated mozzarella cheese, some more Parmesan cheese. Now you can make one layer or you can double them up depending on how many you're making and how big your pan is. And this is where I said it was like a variation of eggplant Parmesan, because when you make an eggplant Parmesan, you would layer the pan with the fried eggplant and Parmesan cheese and a little of the mozzarella cheese, and you would bake it. Mozzarella cheese, you do each line so you make sure no one gets cheated. You always go for the Parmesan with the most mozzarella cheese. And after it's cooked, if you want to throw some fresh basil or parsley on top, you can do that as well. So now we'll just put this right in the oven. And we'll bake that for 45 minutes at 375. Sizzling hot. Grandma's eggplant meatballs. If you'd like to try this dish at home, here's the recipe. Now at home, you can serve them in a casserole dish, or if you want to be fancy, put them in a nice platter to make a show. If you'd like to have your recipe featured on Breaking Bread or a family recipe, you can email us at breakingbread@thesalesmedia.org. Today we visited the parish of Santa Rosalia Regina Pacis and spoke with Charlie Rayo of Mama Rayo's. While we were together, Charlie spoke about how when life gives you lemons, you make lemon drop cookies. I joked that you can also make limoncello. Either way, it is often true in life that things don't always go the way we would like. We sometimes feel we have been dealt a bad hand that leaves us with a bitter and displeasing taste in our mouths. Our faith, however, teaches us that for every Good Friday, there is an Easter Sunday. What are the lemons of our lives? Where are the Calvaries and crosses that we bear in our faith journey? And how can we learn to see the potential sweetness of the lemon drop cookies that we can make out of our sufferings with the help and the grace of God? This is Monsignor Jamie Gigantiello asking that together We continue to build the church by devoting ourselves to community, prayer, the teaching of the apostles, and the breaking of the bread. May God bless you. Thanks for watching.